In nature, you'll notice that the vast majority of sexually reproducing organisms have got two sexes, not one, and very rarely more. Biologists love to ponder about why sexual reproduction evolved in the first place, but today we're asking a very different question. Why do we need sexes for sex, and why specifically two of them? Firstly, to clarify, in this video, the term sex is used interchangeably with gamete types or mating types. Gametes are reproductive cells, and one gamete may only fuse with one of a different type to give rise to a zygote. Given there are generally two gametes or mating types, they are usually referred to as male and female. Male gametes are generally smaller and motile, and female gametes are generally larger and sessile, and carry no further political connotations than that. If you think about it, having two sexes may seem like a very weird setup, because it effectively cuts the population a gamete could potentially mate with in half. You would expect more sexes to appear such that gametes can mate with those of a different type, and in this situation the rarer sex will have the highest advantage, and therefore you would expect more sexes to appear over time. However, this is not what we observe. Although there are cases of multiple sexes in certain fungi species, in almost every other case of sexually reproducing organisms, there are only two sexes. Which raises the question, how did two sexes evolve in the first place? This is a fascinating question for which there are multiple potential theories. One of the more simplistic models is based on size. In the ancestral state, the gametes don't have separate mating types and they are isogamous, which means they are all the same size, and they can all fuse with each other. The larger a gamete, the more resources it can provide to the future embryo, and this is something that we see in seeds. Large seeds can generally last a long time without germinating, and they produce a robust plant when they do finally germinate, but they are also costly to produce. Plants that produce large seeds produce far fewer than those that produce small seeds. Small seeds may only germinate if they land in soil under the right circumstances. They are much cheaper to produce, so whilst the majority may never germinate, they rely on numbers for one to land under the right conditions. A similar setup could be observed in gametes. When two large gametes fuse, the young will be very robust. However, there may be smaller gametes, cheats if you will, who may attempt to fuse with the large gametes. The zygote won't have as many resources as if two large gametes had fused, but still sufficient for it to have a decent start, and less energy would have been invested in producing the smaller gamete. If two small gametes fuse, however, the young would likely be unviable or of low fitness. Therefore, these smaller cheats create conflict, which could be resolved by allowing large gametes to only fuse with smaller gametes, thus leading to the establishment of two mating types. However, in my opinion, this explanation does not provide a full story of how the sexes evolved, but it does provide some very good foundations and an example of conflict resolution. So let's put that theory to a side and move on to the one which I believe holds a lot more strength, the Hurst-Hamilton Hypothesis. Much like the previous scenario, the ancestral state has isogamous unisexual gametes in which all gametes can fuse with all in a haploid population, and like the previous scenario, sexes evolve as a means to resolve conflict. And in this case, it's genetic conflict. You see, when gametes fuse, they both contribute the same amount of genetic material from the nucleus due to the way meiosis and gamete fusion operates. This, however, is not the case with organelles, such as mitochondria, which are the powerhouses of the cells, or the chloroplast, which enable photosynthesis to occur. Organelles have their own separate DNA, and their number within a cell is variable, which means that when two gametes fuse to form a zygote, it is highly likely that one will contribute more organelles than the other, and by extension, one gamete will be supplying more genetic material than the other, and this leads to genetic conflict. And as is the fashion of evolution, it's only a matter of time before an organelle-destroyer gene evolves, which would wipe out the organelles contributed by the other gamete, so that their organelles and respective genetic material are the ones that are passed on to the next generation. And as you may imagine, this mutation would spread like wildfire, as it would quickly eliminate all organelles without said mutation. However, by the time this mutation has reached fixation, it generates a new problem. When two gametes which both carry the organelle destroyer gene fuse, the organelles would wipe each other out, which would be devastating for the zygote, so this would prompt the evolution of a suppressor gene. The suppressor gene would prevent an organelle from destroying organelles from the other gamete, but it would also make their own organelles prone to destruction. The evolution of suppressor genes leads to a situation of heterozygote advantage, whereby the fusion of a gamete with the suppressor gene and one without yields the highest fitness. because you see, the fusion of two gametes without suppressor genes would likely be lethal, whereas the fusion of two gametes with suppressor genes would lead to more diverse organelles, but the zygote also incurs the cost of suppression twice. So the ideal situations for a gamete with suppressor genes and one without to fuse. And because the ideal state is for opposite types to mate, this then leads to the evolution of a brand new Choosy gene. The Choosy gene essentially ensures fusion only occurs with a gamete of the opposite suppressor profile. This is usually done through protein recognition and also represents an additional cost to the gamete, but as long as the benefits from ensuring a heterozygote advantage with each fusion outweigh the costs of having a Choosy gene, it will be worth it, and the gene will slowly become fixed in the population. And the last and final step in this process is associated with the linkage between the Choosy gene and the suppressor type gene. In this case, the linkage refers to the genes being physically close together within the nuclear DNA, which strengthens them being selected together, and therefore guarantees the fixation of both Choosy genes and the suppressor type genes. The outcome of this is anisogamy, which means that the two mating types have a different size. In essence, the gamete with suppression will have its organelles destroyed by the opposite type, so these won't be contributed to the zygote, and will have the bare minimum of organelles to ensure the gamete can find the one of the opposite type. This gamete is generally referred to as the male gamete, and they are generally smaller in size. On the other hand, the female gamete is the one without the suppressor gene, and will be passing on all of her organelles and cytoplasm to the zygote, and is thus much larger in size. This actually matches what we observe in nature, as mitochondria are almost universally maternally transmitted, and the female gamete contributes the majority of cytoplasmic resources to the zygote. You could almost claim this theory shares some parallelisms with the first theory presented, although the conflict occurs at the genetic level, and the difference in size actually reflects the compensation with regards to the organelles contributed to the zygote. Male gametes are generally smaller and cheaper to produce, but they also don't pass on the genetic material from their organelles, whereas the female gametes contribute the majority of the cytoplasm, which is very costly to produce, but they also get to contribute the entirety of their organelle genetic material to the next generation. And boom, there you go, how sexes evolve. Now, I am aware there are two main criticisms that this theory may receive. The first one is, well, Inés, you are aware that this is one out of at least eight other theories. How do you know this is the reason that the sexes originated? And the second one is, if this theory explains how two sexes evolve by having two opposite binary types, then how do you explain species with multiple sexes? And both of these are very valid points. I think an in-depth reply and justification to both of these criticisms would require an entire video in itself, so I will be keeping my answers brief. The answer to the first question I actually believe to be a matter of personal opinion. After all, there are different academics that hold different beliefs, and seven of them did come up with competing theories. The reason I think the Hurst-Hamilton hypothesis is the one that is the most plausible explanation for the origin of the sexes is based on genetic conflict, but it doesn't necessarily always justify how the sexes are maintained, just their origin. As for the criticism of explaining multiple sexes, I actually think their existence is the exception that confirms the rule, because it does actually lend support to the Hurst-Hamilton hypothesis. Organisms that have multiple mating types are relatively uncommon, and the vast majority are found in different fungal species. It appears that those species with multiple sexes either represent intermediate states which are inherently unstable, and therefore they will eventually collapse down to a system of two sexes, or they are species which have found alternative ways of resolving organelle genetic conflict, such that two-sexed would not be a requirement. Nonetheless, regardless of their origin, without a doubt, the origin of the sexes has been a crucial contributor to the development and evolution of more complex life forms as we know them today, and is truly a revolutionary biological event. I hope you enjoyed this video. As always, I appreciate this is a more complicated topic than usual, so do feel free to ask any questions in the comment section below. The other thing is, this video is part of a very exciting collaboration on the topic of evolution. There are various other creators who have covered the evolution of homosexuality, which by the way has actually been requested many times in the comments, the evolution of facial expressions, of selfies, words, and much more. So go check that out in the linked playlist. And likewise, if you've already watched them all and you're in the mood for more evolutionary biology, can I cheekily recommend this playlist, which I'm aiming to expand over the next year. And as always, thank you so much for watching me. I'll see you in the next one.